The MoneroTopia Price Report segment is sponsored by Local Monero. Avoid using KYC exchanges. Buy and sell Monero directly for fiat, peer-to-peer.
Hey. All right, so we got price. All right. Technically, this isn't price, it's hash rate. But since we were just talking about the Monero miners, hey, why not start here? So our hash rate is not looking super impressive. So I don't know. Maybe we have to take a little bit of a suspicious eye towards any alleged Bitmain miner developments. Come on, Bitmain, get on the ball. Like, why have we been dropping in hash rate? If y'all could test a little bit more, do some more hardcore testing of your latest mining units, please, if you don't mind. Just playing. So anyway, yeah. So yeah, we.
Ask them tomorrow. I'll DM them.
Yeah. When new rig, bro. But yeah, it looks like we're kind of been dropping off on the hash rate just a little bit. Which is interesting that kind of slightly resembles the price. Maybe at some point I should try and pull this data. I don't think I can get a CSV of this data, but I bet you I could put an AI on it to look at, like to rip the data off the screen or whatever they call it. So yeah, anyways, that's our hash rate. Turn on your miners, bros. I know the winter's over, so maybe that's part of it, right? Could be some of this drop off could be the end of winter, and so a few people that would otherwise be needing the heat are turning off their hashing. I don't know. That's what the mining looks like. Here's our transactions. We're kind of doing this oscillation thing now at this point. So that was the quote unquote attack. I'm going to call it a white hat attack. And then we're kind of doing a little bit more oscillation here. We're up to 50K. I have to assume that, you know, the real transaction, the organic transaction absent the quote unquote attack is probably right around 25,000. That seems like right about what we were doing before things started taking off. So, I mean, again, I don't really see this as a big problem. We were hoping for people to use the network. We would love if there's 100,000, half a million organic transactions on Monero. If anything, this is just free testing, right? It's a free opportunity for us to look at what kind of problems might be out there. And we found some. So. And also the miners, you know, everyone out there doing the hash rate thing, they're, you know, people are going to get paid out a little bit extra for that. So going on to price, last week we kind of drew these lines right here, a little bit, you know, kind of ad hoc looking at this thing. And we kind of broke down from that, the whole crypto market, actually, after we got off the horn. In fact, I think like right off, right.
It was hilarious. It was literally like half an hour after we ended.
Yeah.
Everything jumped another 5-10%.
I don't know if it was Alaska taking profits, but he got off MoneroTopia and then just smashed the sell button. I don't know. Bro, you got to warn us before you do that. No, I'm just kidding. So yeah, we kind of had that crash down there. But overall, I mean, we're still kind of just sideways. I don't like breaking technical patterns to the downside. This is a pretty short-term pattern. It's really only as of the past couple months, you would call it a sideways triangle. I especially feel not confident when drawing technical analysis patterns for Monero price in particular, just because they break so easily. I just don't necessarily trust them. And of course, you know, we've got Anon Mon that also especially doesn't trust drawing pleb lines either. So, you know, shout out to you, bro. Like you are right in the sense that you do need to be very careful about just drawing a line on a chart and saying, oh, well, it has to obey this. Like basically all pleb lines were meant to get broken at some point. And it only works sometimes. So it's only part of the picture. At any rate, we kind of dropped down to the 100 range here for a brief moment. If the rest of the crypto market pulls back, I'd love to tell you that Monero is going to hang on, and probably it will hang on to a better extent than other stuff, but it could still have some problems. Take a look at the ratio of Monero and Bitcoin. We're on the weekly chart here, so this is a little bit of a larger view. You know, I have the statistics turned on. We'll just mute that for a little bit. So yeah, I mean, we're not at all time lows, but man, I gotta say it's not fun to be down here. Gotta cover it. You know, it is part of price. So it is what it is. We are way down here, and in a technical sense, in the way that I usually see these standard deviation bands play out, I really feel like the way that price just crashed down here, that doesn't give me the warm, fuzzy feeling of organic action. Sorry about that. Let's get back to the chart. There we go. That doesn't give me the warm, fuzzy feeling of organic action. It feels somewhat artificially induced. that's no surprise for anyone that follows crypto markets. Pretty much everyone here knows that there is some level of artificial induction happening in price markets. So again, we're still on this kind of bottoming pattern. It really does look like a bottoming pattern relative to Bitcoin. So this would be accumulation zone. Like, this is where you would want to be purchasing your Monero. And really, that would be true even if we think there's another upleg for the broader markets. If there's another upleg, the cabal is going to want to find a way to sort of suppress Monero's price. And so while everything is pulling back and some people are probably panic selling and degen swing trading and whatnot, there, you know, if you're the cabal that's going to try and control the Monero price, and you know that there's another upleg that you're going to hopefully induce in the rest of crypto, you're going to try and acquire a little bit Monero when things are calm, when things are quiet. So this, again, this could be a bottoming pattern. I say it doesn't matter, right? Like, just keep buying, right? If you keep spending, keep using Monero, and then keep replenishing your bags. If you're a degen trader, roll those profits into Monero. Down in the 100 range, I mean, when Monero's price is at these levels here in the 100 to 110 range, like, to me, that's just a really good opportunity to replenish your bags if you spend Monero. So I'm the kind of guy that's basically always selling crypto. And I don't like to sell anything else other than Monero. So it means that I have to replenish my bags. So selling as I need cash and then rebuying down here, I think is a great way to play that if you're dependent on crypto and degen trading for your livelihood. I don't know how many in the audience would be that, but just FYI. So I thought we could also look at the Monero versus gold ratio today, just because maybe that's a slightly interesting chart. So we are also here on the weekly, and you'll notice it basically kind of resembles the XMR USD chart, very similar, but with some interesting deviations here. So one of the things that I noticed pulling up this chart was that we're at these lower term standard deviation lines, the orange bands down here. Again, I colloquially call this wave magic, which I showed a friend this script, and that's what he called it. And I was like, that's good nomenclature, bro. I'm going to steal that. So yeah, we're sitting here at the lower standard deviation bands, very long-term standard deviation bands. You'll see that these have been forming since 2020, right? Since down here, really actually 2019. So, and this again is Monero relative to gold. This would probably be, again, some kind of bottoming pattern. Hopefully, again, it's probabilistic in nature. You really have to wait and see how things unfold. Typically, what you'll see is some kind of bottoming, and even if it's going to go down farther, you'll see some rebound before it actually does that. One thing that I was telling you guys, if like maybe 2 weeks ago, or maybe it's like 4 weeks ago now, if we turn on the wave magic for Monero US dollar, I didn't like the way, I really don't like the way that this is unfolding here on Monero US dollar. Like, in a technical sense, I don't like it. Right. So basically, we collapse below these very long term lower standard deviation bands, and then we're basically down here, and you can already see that those lower standard deviation bands are curling under. That is just like very classic action that I see from stuff that that tends to go down. So, I mean, I'm not predicting that Monero goes down, because like I told you guys last week on Saturday, you know, I have this, like, I do have an emotional block when it comes to Monero. And you know, I do know that these charts, this doesn't always play out in the way that the chart might suggest or the technical analysis might suggest. So it's totally possible this thing could just break to the upside. That could happen. So I want to believe that will happen, which is a reason I don't trade Monero. I just know that there's too much emotion there that can get in the way. I use Monero and I roll profits into Monero, but I mostly avoid trading it. But from a wave magic perspective, I don't like the way that this is unfolding. Just FYI, right? I'm just telling you guys what I'm seeing out here. That would be the Monero US dollar price, but versus gold, this actually does look like you would expect some kind of pause at a minimum. Monero's price relative to gold is falling, but should pause here at some point and could probably rebound. But gold is on a tear. We'll talk about that in a second, but gold just continues to rise. And I think we should continue to expect it to rise until it gets to some like clear areas. So Bitcoin, probably everybody knows, anyone that cares about Bitcoin's price, crypto prices, knows that, oh my God, everything crashed like 17%, the horrible 17%. This was another pattern that we kind of drew ad hoc on Saturday, and said, well, I don't really know exactly where this thing is going to go. Like, it looks like a pennant, which normally I think you would say is bullish, but anyways, this thing broke down from that. So I think the markets are suspicious right now. I think there's a lot of suspicion about how much further things can go. There's probably a good chance that people have some kind of PTSD from 2021, as well they should, because a lot of people got screwed at the top of the market. There's kind of one thing out here that's on the horizon. I believe it's going to be launched by 420. It's called Runes, and I don't want to be shilling on accident, right? That's something that one of the shitcoin extraordinaires out there taught me, is that when you tell people Project X is a scam, people will be like, oh, let me go look at Project X. Well, this is interesting. And then they buy Project X, and you just basically gave them free advertisement. So nevertheless, at the risk of doing that, this project called Runes is currently on Bitcoin testnet, and it's basically a way to do, I think it's like a standard, and I don't know much about it, so I'm probably going to totally screw this up, but it seems like it's some kind of BRC20 standard that relates into Witness, and you can create all kinds of degeneracy, and people are really excited about it. And they're on testnet. And in fact, there's like testnet coins. They're literally Bitcoin testnet coins now trading at value, if you can believe that crazy shit. Like, to the point that... Yeah, to the point that Jameson Lopp was mining empty blocks on testnet to try and slow them down. I'm sorry, that's so many forms of irony. It's too much to take, honestly. One of the things going to happen here on 420 is that when the halving happens, these rare sats, quote unquote rare sats, which it's like an arbitrarily defined thing, but it doesn't matter because everyone believes it, or at least all the meme degens believe it. So effectively, a rare sat is the first sat of like a special event. So the halving, the very first block, the very first sat mined would be a rare sat. And that would actually be a legendary sat. The mythical sat was the original one mined by Satoshi. Every difficulty adjustment, the first block after every difficulty adjustment, is also a rare sat. So it's like they've got like this distinction. And rare sats get attached to ordinals. So what's going to happen here, this Runes thing is going to be released. I mean, there seems to be so much like hype, degeneracy, excitement from all of the inscriptors that the first block is probably going to go for a massive, massive premium that we'll never know about. But some backroom deal is going to be made with some miners. If they can get their hands on it, right, they're going to try and get it. But the mining in Bitcoin is heavily centralized, and there's a lot of different pools that seem to be operated by effectively the same entity. So something like 50% or more of Bitcoin is
based on that. It is hilarious to think about that all these massive centralized pools are going to compete to fight each other to get the rare sat.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's a big monetary deal for them. Like you have to believe that those guys are going to act in their best profit interest, right? They love the degeneracy. So yeah, it is what it is. But, you know, in terms of price analysis, I got to think that, That's going to contribute to something, right? That's going to count for something. You're going to get all of this degeneracy with the runes and the first block, the rare sat. They're already trading real value on Bitcoin testnet. That's got to count for price in some kind of way here. So maybe that even counts for Bitcoin, for the Bitcoin dominance, right? So we could pull the dominance chart up here. And yeah, dominance has been doing good, had that big spike. Really, as we were talking on Saturday, Bitcoin dominance was spiking. And then right after, has come back down a little bit. But overall, like this chart, I mean, just from the wave magic standpoint, you would say, hey, this chart is slowly but steadily up and up and up. So yeah, I mean, I would just keep that in your mind if you're, I mean, hell, if you can afford the fees on Bitcoin, because we could very well see 100, 500, sats, 1,000 sats per V-byte. That could happen if this thing is like really, really taking off. So yeah, that's that's happening out there. What is it? So 420 is just like 2 days away. So the halving is very close. Yeah, so it wouldn't be surprising to see like a very quick reversal on this chart, even though the pleb lines got broken, which actually I think that was kind of the reason we talked about these pleb lines on Saturday, is because we said, hey, you know, just be careful with pleb lines. You really want to try and get a confirmation. So we're on the daily candles now. You want to get above the line, and then you want to actually confirm a second day close above the line. In this case, you did this like weird oscillation thing and then broke down. And that's why it's like, it's good to sort of do that confirmation thing in your head. Say, let me wait. I'm not just going to jump in. Let's get a 1-2 day confirmation that the thing actually broke the line, and then go for a swing trade. So Yeah, that should be fun. This good time should be had by all on Twitter watching this unfold. There will be a lot of salt. There will be a lot of crying harder, hopefully on multiple sides so that we can maximize the wolves. Crypto Z scores. Let's take a look. Is there anything standing out to us? I don't see anything pumping at the moment. One thing I've noticed is that Link will tend to pump. Like if there's going to be a major move, I'll see Link pumping to the upside very often. I haven't been able to figure out exactly what that is. I try to construct something in my brain where I was like, okay, Link is a cross-chain facilitator of all kinds of degeneracy. So maybe you need to move through Link. If you're like a big market maker, you need to move through Link to sort of push the price on the coins that you want. So Link pumps first. That's a very tentative kind of idea. And Link pumping ahead of everything else is also, you know, it's only half true at best. So let's take a look at some of the YouTube comments. Is there anything good out there that I'm missing here? Hash rate job. Monero is no longer the most profitable network to mine for CPUs. You know, Edward, that's, I can believe that. And you know, the reason that I can believe that, let's go to some of these, let's go to Pirate Chain as one good example. Pirate Chain has pumped 145% in the past 3 weeks. So, one thing that hasn't been lost on me here, and I can't remember, I think we chatted about this last week on Saturday, but one thing that we see is just absolute shitcoins that are not used for anything. Like Monero has real, organic, actual usage in important markets that matter. And other coins that have fucking nothing, they'll pump 100%, 200% for no reason, but Monero just doesn't have that at all. So it's like, why? What is different here? Why does
it? I mean, to be fair, right around that time, Pirate Chain got like a big hard fork, a big upgrade.
Okay. Yeah. That could explain it, but you know, Pirate Chain is just one example, right? We could pull up almost any random coin here and find, you know, within the last few months, in the last 6 to 12 months, find some major like 100% pump that it made in a very short time frame. I just think it's interesting. You know, I think it's just worth pointing out saying that, you know, Monero never gets that kind of pump action anymore. Not that I'm saying, oh God, why don't we get our pump action? It's more, it's not that like I'm crying harder about Monero not pumping sufficiently for my bags. It's about why doesn't it do that? What's different? What's going on here? Maybe that's related to the exchange delistings. And maybe that says something about the insiders in the crypto market and how connected they may or may not be to governments, or under duress they may or may not be as related to governments. So just, you know, something interesting to think about. Okay, let's take a look at the Tether and USDC market caps. Tether continues to rise significantly in terms of its market cap. Pushing 110 billion at this point. USDC kind of recovering, still not at the heights of its heyday back in 2022. One thing that you should note here on this chart, though, is that even after the top was in 2021, Tether and USDC continued to pump to the upside. So my guess is that this chart in many ways is probably used as one of many in a fabric of sentiment generation, right? These charts, the market cap of Tether and USDC are probably used somewhat to help people feel comfortable that more gains are on the way. They're like, oh, well, look, Tether printed another billion, so that must mean more gains, right? And that's going to be true until the day that it's not, right? Because they're going to keep trying to make it look like, even when the top is in, they're still going to try and make you think that, oh, it's just a dip, right? Keep buying, keep buying. We have more bags to unload. So, but it's a valuable, worthwhile chart to take a look at. Again, you're keeping these little pieces in your brain. You kind of want to like keep all of it together as sort of this nebulous cloud, play with the ideas, let them, it's like cloud gazing. You see a face, you let it take shape. You start to see common themes. You hope that as this like aggregated mass of information that's churning around in your brain, that you start to be able to make some sense out of it, which is kind of why I think you want to look across a broad spectrum of things, whether that's hype, the legal situation going on, technical analysis, et cetera. So let's take a quick look at macro and then we'll call it a day. So gold, we'll start with gold because probably people here own gold. I mean, of course you guys own gold. It's gold backs for sure, 100%. We're sitting here at about $2,400, a little bit of a slowdown as of the past week here in the gold price. This looks slightly like, you know, consolidation topping, whatever. I still think probably if we go to the weekly, you know, you don't really see too much of a slowdown. I mean, this thing is just taking off like to the upside, 20%. buckle up. is what Peter Schiff likes to say when gold moves 5%. But at any rate, yeah, I tend to think gold should still keep moving. I have some more ideas on gold that I'll share with you guys maybe like in a month or so. It basically, gold goes up before like a big tail risk event happens, like a big crash will happen. You'll see gold already moving up, and then gold will crash with the market, and then it'll continue going up for a short period of time. But we'll talk about that if we get like, if the signs start showing more likelihood of tail risk. Okay. This is now the dollar index. As we talked about, this thing still looks pretty bullish at this point. I would expect, again, expecting to make the upper standard deviation area somewhere around there. So Dixie still to the upside, I would say, most likely. Reverse repos have kind of leveled out here. So you'll notice that for a period of time since, really basically since March 1st, has been overall flat, a little bit up, a little bit down, but the reverse repos, which is money parked at the Federal Reserve, where you get the overnight federal funds rate. So that's money not in risk assets, not in stocks, not in crypto, just sitting at the Federal Reserve. This is money that could hypothetically go seek higher yield in a risk-on environment. But that money, we haven't seen any new money come out of the reverse repos. And I think, you know, surprise, surprise, that seems to be correlated here with a little bit of a pullback in the stock market. This is the S&P 500. So one thing I did to kind of like prove to myself that the reverse repos actually do have some correlation here, we will go to the correlation coefficient, and then you can type your symbol in right here. This is actually RRPON. I don't know why it's RRPON, but it is. So we'll apply that. In terms of the correlation coefficient, I always like to, I prefer the style to be histogram. I think it just looks better that way. Doesn't matter. You know, maybe we'll make that a brighter color. Hopefully we'll just make it white and we'll make the line thicker. Sorry, kind of like slowing down here. We'll make the link 30 days. But basically what you can see here is that indeed there has been a pretty significant negative correlation since the top of the market, since the 2021 peak, and things started coming down. Basically, you'll see the zero point is right here. And the reverse repos have been inversely correlated with the stock market. So as the inverse repos go down, the stock market goes up. Yeah, there's a few periods here where the correlation goes to the opposite side, but overall, you would say that this is definitely a bias that we're seeing, you know, kind of like a in real time, I guess, over the months, over the years now here. So again, this is kind of why I just think the reverse repos is a big piece of the puzzle in our minds that we need to keep track of. Currently it's flattening out a little bit. Again, my guess is that they're probably trying to save some firepower for the elections so that everyone can feel good that Biden has taken care of the stock market and they got inflation under control. Praise Jay Powell. My God, they're just our saviors from the inflation. And also Yay. The cost of it somehow. let's see. Okay. Bonds. And this is it. So we got bonds here. They've actually been rising. If you're the kind of person that wants like simple, stable yield, now's the time to probably buy yourself a long-term bond. It really is. Like, you are not going to get much better rates here to find yourself a 1 to 5 year bond. That'll give you a guaranteed 4.5% to 5% interest. One thing that I think is interesting here is these red lines. This is the overall inversion, as we've talked about before. I take every single one of these bonds and subtract them from every single other one of the bonds. At least, let me rephrase that. I take every short-term bond and subtract it from every longer-term bond to get the inversion, the overall inversion of this entire mess of lines. What you get down here is a couple red lines. Don't worry, there's two of them. There are two of them. But effectively, the yield curve is still inverted overall, but it's moving towards the upside. To me, this looks like a yield curve that at some point here, maybe in the next year, is probably going to move itself into the positive territory. And that for us is a signal of tail risk increasing. So whenever we get to that point, we'll talk more about it. But yeah, bonds, nothing happening there. And I think that's good enough for today. We've got a big show here for the birthday party. I'll hand it back over to you, gentlemen.
All right, man. Do you remember when Monero hit 420 on 420? That was like the most epic day ever in my entire life. I was like, what? Yeah. Is this really happening right now?
I think that was before my time.
This is, 2-3 years ago? When was the last?
It was, I guess it was 2021. Market. Let's go back to it. Mm-hmm. Take a second to pull the charts back there. But
And the fact that that still didn't get Elon's attention, I was like, well, what, this makes no sense.
Yeah, like, bro, like, you like drugs? Come on.
Right. Like that's his favorite number, 420. Monero hit 420.69 on 420. and no input from Elon whatsoever.
Maybe we would never know, would we?
Maybe it was.
Let's see. Awesome. Right here. This is the candle. Let's. Oh, crap. I'm gonna make. Yeah, this.
I was like in disbelief when that happened. It's like, this is not happening right now.
I mean, you know, somebody had to be like some whale out there. Some. Like,
I'm sitting there smoking weed on 420, looking at Monero's price at 420. I was like, what happened? Like, what just happened? Did I die? I'm no longer here.
I don't even smoke weed, and I was like, dude, we just hit 420, and I like seriously lit up a fucking joint. It's like, I'm gonna do it. That's exactly. Not even my choice at this point.
All right, guys, can we do it? What do we have? We have 2 days. Let's make it happen. That should be the. We should all be on Twitter trying to get Elon to pump Monero for 420. Make it happen again. Bring it back.
Let's at least get 420 live viewers today. So far, all we have is 69. No, I don't know. Looks like 32.
Or we can dump Monero and have it go down to $4.20.
But what it legit hit it on 420 though, right?
This is the Monero chart right here. You can see on the bottom Tuesday, on April 20th, we hit. This is the 4-hour chart. So, right here, 1600, 2000.
Around what time is that?
Right here. So in UTC time, technically that was like right at the end of the day UTC time, but it was still 4:20, like in the evening time for America.
Yeah, and obviously I was very much smoking weed and looking at the price of Monero. It was one of my more memorable moments.
Yeah, it was. Let's just like super zoom in on this. It was this candle right here. There, you'll see, we just barely touched it.
420.69 on 420.
You could get Chad that did the.
Nobody could take that away from us, guys. Like, on top of all the cool, like all the badass things Monero is known for, it's also the only coin to hit 420 on 420. Add that to the list.
I was surprised at how little attention that got. Like, we saw it, but I guess
that's what I'm saying. This is when Elon was like pumping Doge, and he is like Mr. He's always making the 420.69 jokes, and then literally on 420. I think I even like tweeted him that day to try, like, with the hopes that something would happen, but obviously nothing. Yeah, it didn't get much attention considering the odds of it happening.
I wasn't on Twitter at that point.
Oh wow, you weren't even on Twitter at that point.
You're responsible for that, bro. You made that happen.
Oh shit. Well, it's been great. No, I think everybody loves it.
It was actually a very good transition to make from Reddit. My Reddit time was more so me kind of like sort of half open journaling, gathering my thoughts, trying to learn about stuff, debate long form with people to try and understand what's going on, see if like can people bring different arguments, different perspectives. You know, I was on like Buttcoin, I was on the cryptocurrency subreddit, obviously I was in Monero. I was just like trying to get as many perspectives as possible. And then like chat, debate with people to really form as many ideas as I could. And then you convinced me to get on Twitter. So ever since then, it's just been one.
Yeah, I discovered you on the Monero trading subreddit, right? What is this? I've been on
that. Yeah, XMR Trader.
Is that still like active? Are people still?
There's like maybe about a handful of people. Like I'd say probably 10 people that are on the XMR Trader subreddit. And a lot of those guys like, some of those guys, like Monero Fox, for example, was a big part of us understanding, finding the data to indicate what Binance was doing with their fractional reserve scheme. He was, I think, I'm pretty sure it was Monero Fox that like regularly, almost every day, would post the volume in relation to the order book. And he would also post the rates that Binance would give you for loaning them Monero. And it was always really high. Like you could see they were always trying to get people to loan them Monero. And you could see the divergence between Monero's behavior and like every other coin with a competing use case. or a use case that would hypothetically compete with Monero. And you could just see like it was just night and day. Like that, and it was every time that we turned over another stone, another little piece of data to look like, another piece of data to look at, it was just the same story. It always kept pointing the same direction. So, yeah, some of those guys were really instrumental in helping us put this puzzle together.
I didn't see much around the everybody pulled their Monero off the exchanges thing, right? Like, wasn't that part of Monero's birthday in years past?
We didn't. We didn't the do Monero a run on Binance. Yeah, the money run. The Monero run. Okay. I can never pronounce it like I wanted to. The Monero run. It was. I didn't really have much to do with it. Some other guys organized. Hey, let's all test Binance reserves and pull our Monero off on Monero's birthday, 4/18, and that was 2022. And we crushed them. Like we crushed them and all the exchanges. They kept shutting down. Like the weeks leading into this event, they kept shutting down their withdrawals. They couldn't stay open. Monero's price spiked up. Like everything. So that was really cool that year. It was like the smoking gun for us. It was like, after we did that, after we tested their reserves, we organized like just a ragtag team of us tested Binance's reserves and the other exchanges. They couldn't keep their withdrawals open. So that was like a smoking gun. Like, yeah, you guys don't actually have it. That's what we thought. We already knew it. Okay. We've tried to organize, I say we, but they've kind of tried to organize some other money runs, since then. And it's kind of like, we don't want to look like we're trying to exploit this as a way of, you know, pumping our coin. Like that wasn't the point of it. The point was get your money off the exchange, use Monero like it's supposed to, prove what these guys are doing, get that smoking gun evidence. And I really like, I was personally kind of opposed to using that as a way to try and pump the price. It was useful for what we needed, and now it's delisted from Binance. So there's not as much of a reason to do it anymore.
That was our GameStop moment.
Yeah. The Moaz.